Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand. I wanna be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer, this is my plea. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand, and I wanna be standing on your side.
For as many as are, Galatians chapter 3, verse 10, for as many are of the works of the law are under the curse. Now, many times this is interpreted that if you believe in the law of God, you're under a curse. No, if you believe in the law of God for salvation, you're under a curse, because you're putting yourself under the authority of the law. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all the things which are written in the book of the law. That's why Jesus said, if you break this, you've broken all of them. You're under the curse. You took your hand, put it in the cookie jar one time, you're done, you're under the curse. You need a Savior. All men have fallen sin, have fallen short of the glory of God, because all men have sinned. All men have broken the law of God. Read it that way. It'll change the whole context. Galatians 3:11, but that no one is justified by the law in the sight of God is evident, for the just shall live by faith. Yet the law is not of faith, but the man who does them shall live by them. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. It does not say Christ has redeemed us from the law. You see the difference? It's redeemed us from the curse, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Verse 23, but before faith came, the Messiah came, we were kept under guard by the law, kept for the faith which would afterward be revealed. Therefore, the law was our tutor. One of the most misunderstood analogies that has ever been given. I think it's a brilliant analogy now. At the time when I first looked at this, I really struggled over this. So before Jesus came, we were kept under guard by the law. It's the authority. It's Barney 5. Kept for the faith which would afterward be revealed. Therefore, the law was our tutor to bring us to Christ that we might be justified by grace. Again, Greek thinkers go like this. Law, Christ. Tutor to bring us to Christ. Ah, we got Christ. We don't need the tutor anymore. We don't need the law anymore. But let's read it carefully and see if that's what it says. First of all, let's put it in its analogy format. A tutor is what? The teacher. So a dad is the father. He goes away to work, and he hires a tutor while he's gone to teach the youngster. Okay? The youngster is the heir to the entire property, the whole inheritance. He's being taught by the tutor. Who's in charge while the dad's away? The tutor. Now, by default, if we believe that the law of God is done away with, and we use this verse to say that, the law was unto Christ, then what we are really saying, when the father comes home, he shoots the tutor in the head. We don't need the tutor. That's crazy. You don't shoot the tutor. You need him tomorrow. Cheryl, can you shut that door for me over there, please? So let's read it a little carefully. Therefore, the law was our tutor to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified, saved by faith. But after faith come, we are no longer under the authority of the tutor. And what is the tutor? The law. While the Messiah is away, you are under the authority of the law. It has jurisdiction over you and authority to condemn you. But when Sheriff Taylor walks in the door, Barney is not in charge anymore. The law has no authority to condemn you. There is no condemnation for those who are under the Messiah. The tutor must step down. Does that mean that all of the rules and the commandments and the instructions that the tutor gave the youngster do not apply? Or does it just mean that there's been a transfer of authority? You see, when you talk about authority, everything lines up. Galatians is a piece of cake. He's very simply saying that the law was in charge until the Messiah. Then the Messiah took over. Now he's the administrator of the law. He decides who dies and who lives. And he just goes, pardon. You see, opens up the jail. For you are all sons of God through the faith in Christ Jesus. For as many as of you were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, in Galatians 3:28. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Promise given to Abraham. So let's move on to chapter 4, because it gets a little bit more difficult. We're going to read 4:1 through 5:14. I tried to get out of not reading this, but it's impossible. We need to read it all. So turn to chapter 4, please, Galatians. Galatians 4. And what did I say? 4:1 through, okay. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from a slave, though he is master of all. But it is under guardians and stewards until the time appointed by the father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. When the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the jurisdiction in the system of the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. And because you sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your heart, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, now who is He talking to, by the way? Who are the groups? Who is He talking to? Jews or Gentiles? Galatians. Let me give you a hint. Galatians actually comes from the Hebrew word galut. You crazy galut? Who said that? Simony Sam, the Bugs Bunny, Jewish writer. Galut means Gentile. Okay? So these are the church of the Gentiles. These are Gentiles, not Jews. They've never been Jews. Very, very important as we walk through here. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. The heir, what are we talking about when they say heir? You're a Jew, I say heir. Your first thought is what? So you're not Jews, so you don't have a first thought. But if you were Jews and I say heir, the first thought is Abraham. Okay? I'm an heir. I mean, everything went back to Abraham. I am from Abraham, right? So that's what we're talking about. Jews did not believe Gentiles could be of Abraham. But then indeed, when you did not know God, so they did not know God because they weren't Jews. They didn't know anything about God. You served those which by nature are not gods. They were polytheistic, serving idols. But now after you know God, or rather you are known by Him, how is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements to which you desire again to be in bondage? I can't tell you how many times I've heard that this is the law of God he's talking about. That the Gentiles are returning to the law which they knew nothing about. Pagan cultic Gentiles returning to Judaism. Something's wrong with this statement. You see how we read in the text what we believe? No, what's going on? What's happening is this. They used to not know God and they were in a religious cultic system. When they were in this religious cultic system, they were under the bondage of the religious leaders that they were under at the time. Okay? They had everything the same thing the Jews did. Sabbaths, new moons, festivals, feast days. Just meet any cultic, Satanist or Wiccan today, and they have their own holidays, their own Sabbaths. They go by the new moon, everything. The problem is, when I say Sabbath, you think of Jew, don't you? Not knowing that almost all of the religions at the time kept Sabbaths and holy days and feast days to their gods. Remember that. So these are Gentiles, not Jews. So as we read through this, but now you're known by God. How is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements? What are the weak and beggarly elements? What is bondage always associated with in the Scripture? Sin puts you into bondage. And where does sin come from? Not doing what God wants you to do. Doing what man wants you to do. The traditions and doctrines of men put you into bondage as well as sin. Okay? It's the only two things that can create bondage. You observe days and months and seasons and years. I'm afraid for you, lest I have labored for you in vain. Now, it seems very clear that he's saying that you're observing the Sabbath, and I can't believe you're doing this. You're observing all these things that the Jewish people do. You're returning back to this. Well, the big key is they're not returning back to Judaism for sure. They've never been a Jew in their life. They don't even know what that means. They don't know anything about that stuff. They're returning to a slave mentality of letting someone rule over them and tell them what it means to be saved. And they're letting this circumcision party, remember the debate, remember the groups, this group has apparently infiltrated the Galatian church and has convinced them that they're not saved and that they need to do certain things in order to be saved. Paul didn't catch this one right away. And so the circumcision party infiltrated the Galatian church and began to teach them that you need to do this, this, and this, and this. And he says, don't you get it? You just came out of a system of slavery, religious people, and now you're walking right back into a religious slavery again. New religion, same slavery. Now you're observing days and times and years just like they tell you to do all these things. I fear for you that you're not even saved anymore. I've labored in vain. Brethren, I urge you to become like me, for I became like you. You have not injured me at all. You know that because of physical infirmity, I preached the gospel to you at the first. In my trial, which was in the flesh, you did not despise or reject, but you received me as an angel of God, even as the Lord Jesus. Okay? I love this verse, verse 20. I would like to present with you, to be present with you now and change my tone, for I have doubts about you. Tell me, you who desire to be under the law. Remember, here it is again. Galatians was written right after the book of Romans. So, you tell me, those that want to be under the penalty of the law, do you not hear the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by the bondwoman, one by the free woman. This is a difficult story here, but hopefully we'll unpack this and you'll see that it's actually pretty simple. He who was of the bondwoman, remember Abraham had two wives, Sarah and Hagar. Okay, Sarah was of the promise because Yahweh came to him and promised that they would have a son, Isaac, through Sarah. Abraham didn't believe, Sarah didn't believe. Go into my maidservant Hagar, so out came Ishmael as the firstborn. So now we have children of the promise, which is of Sarah, and we have children of bondage of Hagar. He's going to use this analogy to show what religious systems do. Which religious system do you want to be a part of? He says, these things are symbolic, for these are the two covenants. One from Mount Sinai, which gives forth birth to bondage, which is Hagar. Okay, stop for a second. This sure looks like he's saying, what came from Mount Sinai? If I say Mount Sinai, what came from it, you're going to think the law. Okay? So now it seems like Paul is saying that the law is bondage. This is very important stuff. First of all, as we know, he would be contradicting himself all over the place if that was the case. Because, you know, in Timothy it says that it's not bondage, and it's not burdensome, and it's free and perfect. But outside of that, let's walk through the scripture. Which give birth to bondage, which is Hagar. For this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and corresponds to Jerusalem, which now is. It's talking about religious systems. Okay? Jerusalem at the time of the first century was bondage all over the place because of their under the law, all these oral laws that they had added, created a monster, and it put the people in bondage. Okay? That's one covenant, the covenant of bondage. For this Hagar is Mount Sinai and Arabia, and corresponds to Jerusalem, which now is, and is bondage with her children. But the Jerusalem above is free, which is the mother of us all. Rejoice, O barren, you do not bear. Break forth and shout, you who are not in labor. For the desolate has many more children than those who has a husband. Talking about Sarah. Now we, brethren, as Isaac, are children of the promise. But he who is born according to the flesh then persecuted him who was born according to the Spirit, even so now. Nevertheless, what does the Scripture say? This is a dangerous verse that people misinterpret. This is, by the way, what Hitler used to kill all of the Jews. This is one of the major verses that he used. Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman or Hagar. We are children of the free. So stand fast in your liberty. Now, let's go back to the Mount Sinai in Arabia. Verse 24. For these are the two covenants, the one from Mount Sinai, which gave birth. This is the key that I read through and read past for years. Mount Sinai is the law of God. The law of God, they didn't get it, so and they didn't understand how to put it all together, so it gave birth to a religious system, you see. That's the key. It's not Mount Sinai that's the problem. It's what gave birth after Mount Sinai was the oral law and the traditions and of the elders that came from Mount Sinai that put the people in bondage. There's no way in Hades that apostle, disciple, Rabbi Shaul is saying that the law of God is bondage. It's anathema. Because it would be a major contradiction of all the other writings. He can't uphold something that's bondage. Okay? He is talking about the religious system that it gave birth to. Does everybody see that? The law of God, the Mosaic law given on Mount Sinai, gave birth to Jerusalem in its current state. He says, we are not children of the bondwoman. We are children of the free woman. We are the children of the promise that was given to Abraham without all these religious stigmas and laws that were added. So kind of difficult, but you got to just catch the key verses there. And again, if we interpret that it's bondage came from Mount Sinai, then we violate number 4. Because then it's going to violate all kinds of contradictions of what we already know. Okay? In Timothy, the book of Timothy, all scripture cannot be worthy of instruction in way of righteousness. That's an absolute lie. Because then he's saying that all scripture is bondage. How can it be worthy of anything? Then we should throw it away. No. Clearly he's talking about the religious system. And so what he's saying here is that do not go back to another religious system just like the one you came from. Let's keep going. Stand fast. And indeed, verse 2, I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing because you're giving into a religious system. And now it's not about following the law of God. It has nothing to do with the law of God at this point. It's about following a religious system. They want to put them in bondage. And now he's going to prove it right here. I testify again that anyone becomes circumcised, he is a debtor to keep the entire law. Because if you're going to base your salvation on circumcision, you better keep all of it. Because if you break it one time, you're cursed. You've become estranged from Christ. You attempt to be justified by law. You have fallen from grace. Kind of solves the whole once saved always thing right there. For we through the Spirit eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avail anything but faith working through love. It's the point and principle of the entire law. You ran well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion does not come from him who calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in you in the Lord that you will have no other in mind. But he who troubles you shall bear his judgment. Now Paul is really getting upset. And you'll see that as he talks here. And I, brethren, if I still preach circumcision, why do I still suffer persecution? In other words, that's what he used to do. Then the offense of the cross has ceased. I could wish that those who trouble you, even themselves, be cut off. Meaning I wish they'd go emasculate themselves. You can look that up later. Verse 13, for you, brethren, have been called to liberty. Only do not use your liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. Two more verses. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. That is the fulfillment, filling up the pitcher. The point of the whole pitcher to begin with is to refresh you. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you consume one another. Okay? So there is Galatians chapter 4 and 5. Almost finished. 5:18 says, but if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. You're not under the authority of the law if you're led by the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Why? Because if you're doing those things, the law is not against you. It's only against you when? Same today, when you break. Ephesians chapter 2, this is a tough one. I know we're switching gears quick, but We're running out of time. Verse 15, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace. Here we go. Is he abolishing the law of God right here and nail him to the cross? Let's find out, because it sure sounds like it. I really can see how we've gotten off the path, because all these scriptures are difficult if we look at them through our Gentile, Greco-Roman, 21st century eyes, and not the eyes of the author. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, what does enmity mean? Hatred, anger, okay, separation. That is the law of commandments contained in ordinances. Is the law of commandments hatred, or is it what creates the dividing wall? The law, when you break it, creates enmity between you and God. Let's keep going. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, is the gift of God. I have no idea how that got in there. Oh, we're starting over in verse 8. So we're a few verses up. Not of the works, lest anyone should boast. Therefore remember that you once Gentiles in the flesh, who were called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. Are you kidding me? When was the last time you heard a preacher say that we are part of the commonwealth of Israel? I don't see Christian in here anywhere, my friend. I see from the mind of God, from the mind of Paul, a very biblical macro idea of the people of Yahweh are called Israel. Okay? They're not called Christians. I hate to tell you, I apologize if that offends you. It is man that calls this Christian. There is no Christian in God's eyes, I hate to tell you. He's either a child of God or you're not. It's either you are Israel, you're part of Israel, or you are a pagan. That is his perspective. We can call ourselves whatever we want, and I'm not against the Christian. I'm just saying from his perspective, there is no Greek, no Jew, no male, nor female, no Catholic, no Baptist, no Christian. There is either you are part of the olive tree and grafted in, or you are not. We used to be not part of the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from all of the covenants. What is this implying? That now, in the Messiah, you who were once far off are brought near by the blood of the Messiah. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one. What? Now we think Jew and Gentile. That is not in the perspective of Yahweh. There's only two in his book that count. And it's the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. It's Israel. The northern kingdom became Gentiles. In Isaiah, I believe, it says the green olive tree, Israel, is called a green olive tree. They broke the covenant. He split them in two. That's where the two kingdoms came from. At the end of time, he says that he is going to graft the two sticks back together so that the stick be one stick in the hand of the Messiah and all Israel will be saved. We think of all the Jewish people are getting saved. That's not what it says. It says all Israel will be saved because his perspective, 2,700 years ago, Israel never came back. The kingdom is only one. It's supposed to be two houses, one in the north, one in the south, all under one king. You see? So that's what's going on. He's going to break down the middle wall of partition, which, by the way, in the temple, there was actual, I think, a 3 or 4 foot wall that the Gentiles could not go past. They were forbidden. It was called the wall of separation. Okay? Or the wall of partition. And Paul is actually referencing, most likely, this middle wall of partition, saying that this wall that keeps the Gentiles from the Holy of Holies is going to be broken down. The Messiah now allows anyone to come into the Holy of Holies. And he's going to take both sticks and make them one. Having abolished in his flesh the law. Is that what it says? It says, having abolished in his flesh the enmity. The wall that separates them, the hatred, because they're condemned. Why did the Jews hate the Gentiles to begin with? Because from their perspective, they're condemned. They can't be saved. They're dirty dogs. But what God has called clean, let no man say is unclean. So because they're now clean through Messiah, There is no separation between Jew and Gentile. The hatred is gone. That's what's happening. He's not abolishing the commandments for crying out loud. Then he's abolishing sin. He's abolishing the hatred, the condemnation. Having abolished in his flesh the hatred, that is, the law of commandments contained in ordinances, what the law does. And I'll prove that in a minute in the Greek. So as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace, that he might reconcile them both to Yahweh in one body through the Messiah, therefore putting to death the enmity. He makes it clear again, not the law, putting to death the hatred, the separation. What separated them was the condemnation of the law. And he came and preached peace to you who are far off and those who are near. For through him we both have access to one Spirit in the Father. Now watch this. If you don't believe me, we go directly to the Greek, word for word, English translation of verse 15. Here's what it says in the Greek, word for word. He is our peace, who has made both on breaking down the dividing wall of hostility, the enmity in his flesh, making powerless the law of the commandments from one new man, making peace. Broken English, ridiculously clear. And the key is right here, making powerless the law of the commandments. He abolishes the hostility. Because there's a comma in the English that says, which is the commandments, we misunderstand it. It's not the commandments he's getting rid of. He's getting rid of the enmity or the hatred that is caused by the power that the commandments have over you. Does anybody see that this is the same message in every single book we've gone through? The law condemns you because you break it. You need a Savior. The Savior took care of the curse and you're free. Can I get an amen for that? Amen. We're not saying anything new. It really is. That's what I'm saying. When we're done, this New Testament should shrink because it's the same message in every epistle. It's just said over and over from different angles. And quite frankly, Paul really is brilliant. He comes up with so many neat angles on how to explain the same thing. The Bible's so darn hard to understand because we think it's 50 different topics. It's one. What does it mean to be saved? Now, therefore, you Gentiles, us, you are no longer strangers and foreigners. And this won't fit well inside the four walls of a church, what I'm going to say, which isn't me. But you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. Which means that means there's someone else that we're part of. It's called the Commonwealth of Israel. You're an Israelite. You may be an American Israelite. And I prove that we're Israelite because we like fast food. We like things the way we want. We're stubborn. We want to do what we want to do. And we don't like the law. You go back to Mount Sinai, it's just Americans. We're fat and lazy, and we want to go back to Egypt. There's no satellite out in the desert. Move into Colossians. Here we go, this is it. One of the culminations, top three. Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he took it out of the way and he nailed the law to the cross. After everything that we've talked about, should I even have to explain what this verse is? Okay. But let's do it anyway. Because it is a little bit ambiguous. Because we hear handwriting of requirements, and what do we instantly think of in our pagan Gentile non-understanding scripture background? The law of God. What other ordinances is there? Well, so let no one judge you. These are some other difficult verses. So let no one judge you in food or drink or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbath. Okay, Jim, I can't tell you how many people have you. Jim, don't tell me I got to keep the Sabbath. Right here, you can't judge me. Well, let's find out if that's what that means. Which are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. So let's ask the four questions. Who are the groups involved? Who are the boots in Colossians chapter 2? Okay? Well, I'll give it to you because we don't have time to walk through it. We have the circumcision party showing up again. It's like they got a Cadillac flying around to every church, you know, private jet, As soon as Paul's out of town, it's like they got a spy. All right, we can land, you know? And they're working their way in here. Circumcision party is at hand, but more importantly, now I'm not going to give it away. I'm going to see if you can catch this. Is remember the four groups that I talked about in the very beginning? One of those groups we have not talked about, they're going to show up right here in Colossians chapter 2. It's going to be very obvious. It'll be some key words. You'll get it. So let's not do that. Let's just read on. Colossians 2, 4. All right. And this I say, lest any man should beguile you. Look for hints here, guys. That anyone should deceive you by fine-sounding arguments through persuasive words. For though I am absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in the spirit, rejoice to see your good order and the steadfast of your faith in Christ Jesus. So he builds them up and then he's going to yell at them. As you have... It's a good teacher, right? You're really good, but you're such an idiot. Beware, verse 8, lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. Big, dead giveaway for the rest of the chapter. Who is he telling him to look out for?
Gnostics.
The Gnostics. The Jewish Gnostics. The dead giveaway is the philosophy, empty deceit. And there's some other giveaways later, okay? But we're going to nail this down to, right now it could be the circumcision party, it could be the Gnostics, but it actually is the Jewish Gnostics that we're dealing with here, okay? The issue is that they have vain philosophy, vain deceit, and traditions of men. You have got to understand who's talking. Traditions of men are being imputed onto these converts. Keep that in the back of your mind as we read through here. Verse 11, in him you were also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. See, they are circumcised. That's the key there. They are circumcised. They're not uncircumcised. They're not obeying the law. They are circumcised. They're cut in the heart. Verse 12, buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead, and you being dead in your trespasses, which is breaking of the commandments. Again, same story. You broke the law, you're condemned to death. He has made alive together with him, having forgiven you trespasses. You're crucified with Christ. Same message again. Verse 14, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us. What is against you? When you get a ticket for going too fast and that officer pulls up to your window with a little piece of paper, what is that called? A ticket. It can also be called handwriting of requirements that are against you. Because it, on the ticket has the law that you broke, does it not? It has the handwriting of the requirement that is standing against you because you broke it. Okay? Interestingly enough, let's read it in the Aramaic. The Lamza says this. Verse 14. And by his commandments he canceled the written bond of our sins, which stood against us, and took it out of the way, nailing to the cross. Folks, does that not make a lot more sense? That what's standing against you is your sins? That you broke the law of God? You're condemned by the law. The written code of the law requires death. And what's standing against you is the law saying, you broke this law. Do you know that when Satan stood before God, when he stands before God, and the Bible says that he is the accuser of the brethren, why does he even have the right to stand before Almighty Yahweh and accuse you? What do you think he's actually pointing to?
The law
that you broke. If you lusted with your eyes, you broke the law of God. That is why he has the right to stand before Yahweh. Have you ever thought about it that way? He's not randomly saying, oh, they did this and they did that. He would have no case in front of the judge. He is the prosecutor of you because he knows the law. And he pulls it out and says, according to 17.983, you broke the law. This person broke the law. And Yahweh says, yep, you're right. You got me there. Then he pulls out the blood and paints across that law. The ticket is taken care of. By the way, Satan, thank you for writing that ticket. Let me nail that one to the cross too. That's what he does for us. Now, come on, we believe that as believers. We believe that Jesus paid for our sins. Amen. He paid for the tickets that stood against us. That's what's happening in Colossians chapter 2. We'll go back to the New King James Version. Now, all that being said, verse 15 makes right perfect sense. having wiped out the handwriting requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, he has taken out of the way, having nailed to the cross, having disarmed the principalities and powers of this present darkness, he has made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them. He put down the powers of the enemy because he destroyed the ability for them to stand against you, pointing to the laws that you broke. So all that being said, verse 16, remember what he just said up to this point is the Messiah paid for your sin. You are free from the bondage of this religious garbage. Beware of these people that are going to come to you and try to teach you with vain philosophy and deceit. Do not let them judge you in food or in drink or regarding a festival or a new moon or a Sabbath, which are shadows of things to come, but the substances of Christ. So what do you think is happening? The same thing that's been happening in every epistle. These groups fly into town and start to tell Paul's converts, you got to do all these things to be saved or you're not part of our country club. Okay? So they're saying, yes, there is a Sabbath. Yes, there is new moons. And yes, there is. But you got to do all these things our way. And Paul's saying, don't let them judge you for those things. Do things the way that I taught you to do them. Okay? At very bare minimum, before we read the rest of the context, if I was debating with someone, I would say, if you're going to be intellectually honest, we both have to throw this verse out. Because it can actually be read, let no one judge you for don't let anybody tell you to keep the Sabbath, or don't let anyone tell you how to keep the Sabbath, or because you're keeping the Sabbath. Thank you. Okay, it can actually be read both ways. Your bias will determine what you get out of this particular scripture. But the context following is going to tell us exactly what verse 16 means. If it's, are they judging for doing the commandments of God, or are they judging them for the way that they're actually keeping the commandments of God? Let no one cheat you, verse 18, of your reward, taking delight in false humility and worship of angels. Bingo, now we know we're talking about Gnosticism. Intruding into those things which they have not seen. Remember what I said, what is the basic of Gnosticism? Gnosis, secret knowledge, higher knowledge, things that they have not seen. Okay? Vainly puffed up in their own fleshly mind. They think they've got this special knowledge. Not holding fast to the head, the Messiah, from with the whole body, nourished and knit together by joints and ligaments, grow with the increase that is from God. Therefore, if you died with Christ from the basic principles of the world, okay, the world, it's all about the traditions of doctors and men, the world. You died from the basic traditions of the world. Why, as though living in the world, do you subject yourself to their regulations of the world? You see that? Do not touch, do not taste, do not handle. Now stop there. Most folks that interpret this scripture is, Jim, it says right here that we're not supposed to go back to the dietary laws of do not touch, do not taste, all the things that are written in the Torah. But that's not what it says, because verse 20 makes it very clear that the definition of what they're going back to the regulations is the principles of the world. And the next verse gives it very clear away, verse 22, which all concern things which perish with the using according to the commandments and the doctrines of men. If he's telling them, listen, don't let these Jews tell you that you need to keep the law, then what he's doing by default is calling the very law of God the tradition and doctrine of men. Does everybody see that? He can't possibly be doing that, because the Torah came from God. It's not a tradition of men. It is all these extra laws that were added that this the Gnostics bought into that are trying to impose on his converts. And Paul is abrogating against that. Okay. These things indeed have an appearance of wisdom in self-imposed religion. It's not a religion from God. This is self-imposed religion. False humility, neglect of the body, but are no value against the indulgence of the flesh. Man-made stuff. Again, if you understand the debate, the groups, the terms, what you'll see is today, the same thing is going on. We have man-made tradition and doctrine that has crept into the Word of God and has paralyzed the people of God. So the only power that we have is literally Christ and Him crucified. And we're so excited to get the milk of the word that Paul calls the milk of the word, by the way. Did you know that Jesus and him crucified is called the milk? It's the only thing that jump starts. It's not the meat. Hebrews 6:1. Whoever wrote Hebrews, that's what he says. He rebukes them because they're still teaching Jesus and him crucified, and that's it. They're not going any further. And he says that's the milk. That's just the basic 101. That's the beginning. We got to get past that because the power flows through the depth of the word as you grow. A 15-year-old that's still drinking milk is not going to be very strong. Got to have the meat. And I believe this is the last book that we'll have to go through is Hebrews chapter 7 and just 10 verses. For on one hand, there is the annulling of the former commandment because of its weakness and profitable. Is Paul saying, it's not Paul, excuse me, is the author of Hebrews saying that the commandment is weak and unprofitable? Sure sounds like it. Let's find out. Hebrews 8, 1 through 13. You turn with me there. I know this is a lot. You get a chance to review this later, but it's important that we finish. Now, all the things which I have spoken of, this is the sum. This is the point of everything that I've said. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and the true tabernacle which the Lord erected and not man. For every high priest is appointed to offer both gifts sacrifices. Therefore, it is necessary that this one also have something to offer. For if he were on earth, he would not be a priest, since there are priests who offer the gifts according to the law, who serve the copy and the shadow of the heavenly things as Moses divinely instructed them. But now he has obtained a more excellent ministry, talking about the Messiah, inasmuch as he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established on better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then no place would have been sought for a second. Now, is the author saying that the first covenant itself was not perfect, that it was faultless? Or sounds like it, but he actually clarifies what he means a little bit later. Actually, the next verse. Because finding fault with them commandments, or them people. You see, I'm from southern Missouri. I can say that. No, the fault was not in the covenant. It was with the people. Remember, Jeremiah 31 says, I am going to make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the one that I made with their forefathers and whom they broke. They broke the covenant, you see. So what's happening is the covenant was not faultless. It was the people. The people. He found fault with them. And then he quotes Jeremiah 31. Go figure. Verse 13, in that he says a new covenant, he has made the first obsolete. Jim, this looks really, really bad for your all of these scriptures. We now understand, but are we saying here in Hebrews that the entire old covenant is obsolete and done away with? Now, what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. Then indeed, even the first covenant had ordinance of divine service and earthen sanctuary, and then he goes on from there. Here's the bottom line. The old covenant is administered through who? A high priest. Who is what? Human. And humans, the high priest, once a year when he made a sacrifice for the people, before he made a sacrifice for the people, what did he make a sacrifice for? Himself. Okay, because there was fault in him as well. If you have a death, remember the whole analogy. If there's a death, there's a change in the law. And because the death of the Messiah was the Passover, Yom Kippur sacrifice, the once a year sacrifice for the sins of all the people, he took the place of the high priesthood. That makes the entire old covenant totally obsolete in its present form. I'll give you an example. And I've given this example many times. Today in America, we understand contracts. Okay, I have contracts with agents all over the country. And they have two commission schedules. They start out on one. So they sign a contract, 8% commission. If they reach a certain level of production, they get a 10% commission. Now, can I just call them up and say, good job, you now are earning 10% commission? No. They have to do what? Sign a new contract. So I send them a completely brand new contract that they must sign. The first contract is totally null and void in a court of law. The second that I give them the new contract. Here's the question. Did I change anything in the verbiage of the original contract except for the 8 to the 10? It's a brand new contract. The old is totally null and void. Now you have to look at that. This from this perspective, this Hebraic perspective. By the way, the whole book of Hebrews is about the high priesthood. It's about the priesthood and the ceremonial sacrificial system. It is changed because there is a new high priest. So the entire old covenant, the way that it's administrated, is obsolete. There's a brand new covenant. It just so happens that the new covenant is the old covenant with a new high priest. But because you have a new covenant, there it's brand spanking new. Does that make sense? Okay? If you read it carefully, and we don't have time, but if you go back and read Hebrews 1 through Hebrews 9, you will see that it fits right in there and it's obvious. The only subject being talked about of the entire law of Moses is the priesthood. And he's removing the human priest, putting in a new priest, and because he does that, there's a change in the law. And by the way, the proof of this fact is that he cannot abolish the old covenant. If he means in the scripture that the old covenant is abolished, he just abolished the priesthood. Because the priesthood is part of the old covenant. If you get rid of the old covenant, you cannot have a Levitical priesthood, therefore you have no sacrificial system, therefore you don't have need a sacrifice, therefore you don't need a high priest, and you're still dead in your sins. And so am I. Proof, the number one proof that the law of God is in effect for today, is there is a high priest still officiating at the altar for you, for me, for my sin, for yours, putting his blood on the horns of the altar. If it was not so, there cannot be a high priest. If there's no law, there's no definition of sin, you can't break it, we don't need a savior, there's no curse, on and on it goes. It's an illogical cycle that we go through. The high priest exists, my friends, because the old covenant is in effect. In 9:15, it says this, and for this reason he is a mediator of the new covenant by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions, breaking the law under the first covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. He's the mediator of the new covenant. Man is not, therefore there's a new covenant. You cannot have the old covenant and change anything. If you change anything, it's a brand new contract. I lied. That wasn't the end. I know you're shocked. I know you're shocked. Hey, listen, when Paul did this, now you know why people fell out of windows falling asleep. See, y'all just haven't been trained to stay up all night talking about the Word. You're used to 20-minute sermons in and out, and you're in Denny's, right? That's why Denny's is open 24 hours. Be doers of the Word, not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. If anyone's a hearer of the Word and not a doer, he's like a man observing his natural face in the mirror. He observes it, walks away, forgets what he looks like. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty, the law of God through the Messiah, and continues in it, he is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work. This one will be blessed in whatever he does. Psalm 19:7 says, the law of the Lord is perfect, able to convert the soul. If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scriptures, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted as the law's transgressors. For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble at one point, he is guilty of it all. Remember, same James that wrote that penned Acts 15. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. Now if you do not commit adultery, but murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. Time out. If the law of God is done away with, how can James even bring it up? Why would he even bring it up as an example if it's done away with? There's only four things they got to do, remember? How can he say that adultery is breaking the law of God? He didn't mention that in Acts 15. So speak and so do as those who be judged by the law of liberty. He falsely misunderstood this concept of law of liberty as something other than the law of God. The law of God, remember, is perfect from Yahweh's perspective. It is absolutely perfect. There was nothing wrong with it from day one. It was man that broke it. The law of liberty is the Messiah. The law, let me just say it differently, the light bulbs will go on. Law of Moses. Law of the Messiah. Law administered by Moses. The law administered by the Messiah. You get that? Isn't that cool? It's not a new law. It's not this new law of liberty that you're free from the bondage of the law. Try telling that to the police officer next time he pulls you over. And here's proof right here. Verse 11, do not speak evil of one another, brethren. Because if you speak evil of a brother, you're judging, you're speaking evil against the law. And you're judging the law of God. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge of it. There is one lawgiver. To a Jew in the first century, who is that? Who gave the law on Mount Sinai, folks?
Moses.
It was given by Yahweh to Moses. Moses gave it to the people. There's one lawgiver, Yahweh. One who is able to save and destroy. Who are you to judge? He uses the Messiah as his arm to save mankind. You better be careful when you judge people, he says, or you'll be judged by the law. Remember that you're going to stand in line one day, is basically what he's saying. All right, now here we are finished. I'm wrapping up. We like things that are simple that we can figure out, do we not? We like checklists. My wife learned, it took 6 or 7 years for her to learn this. It takes me a lot longer to learn stuff, but I kept telling her, I can't do things without a list. I get too distracted. I am HDDD. DDD. Give me a list, I'll get it done. I should have never told her that. The law is on purpose made a bit ambiguous, okay? Because I know if this is new to you, you're thinking of, oh my goodness, what all these laws? Are you saying we got to keep all these laws? No, I'm saying you need to get on the highway and let the Spirit show you which laws are you're in violation right now. Which are you for in Acts 15? They are difficult. They are a little bit ambiguous, but it's for a purpose. It's so that you'll be forced to go to the Father for help and how to do all this. How do I get back in covenant? Your forefathers left the covenant. How do we get back? It's through the Spirit. We don't like that. Men don't like relationship. Just show us how to do it. Just give us a book. I like this. The Lord gave me this today. This is new edition. The law is like a woman. I'll prove it. You laugh. Watch. We don't understand all the laws and how to keep them. We don't understand all the nuances of a woman and how to keep her happy either. If you believe Yahweh that the law is perfect and worthy of all doctrine, reproof and instruction in righteousness, then you will see that it is higher than you and the value that it has in studying it. Let me say that again. If you believe Yahweh that the law is perfect and it's worthy of all doctrine, like 2 Timothy says, reproof and instruction in righteousness, then you will see that it is higher than you, because you're not perfect. It's higher than you, and you will see the value in studying it for your life. You see that? I'll prove why it's just like a woman. Because if a man recognizes that a woman was created as his helpmate, and he recognizes that this means by default that he needs help, then he realizes that she is higher than himself. And then there is much to gain by studying her. Now, don't need to go buy any marriage books. That's it. You figure this one statement out and practice this, you'll have a perfect marriage. Study your wife. She's the Torah. Because your wife is a mirror. So the next time that she yells at you, it's him yelling at you through her mouth. Because she's the mirror that God put in front of you. All right, that's a marriage lesson. Next. In the same way, until we see value in the law of God and not see it as a burden, we can never truly experience the intimacy, the love, the joy, and the happiness that was promised to those who keep it. It is a blessing to those who keep it. Only for those who see it as value. The law only becomes death to you when you break it, when you lose the value in it, and you do not seek repentance through the Messiah. Now watch this. A wife only becomes death to you when you break her heart. Stop studying her, do not see her value, and you don't seek repentance. It works the same. I've been there many times. And it's the same thing in reverse. A husband becomes death to you. You don't even want to be around them only because you stop seeing the value that they add to your life. So you walk away from the law and you die. So whether a husband ever admits it or not in public, every man knows that the woman is the law. Okay? Only women are laughing. It's kind of women know truth when they hear it, right? I can humble myself and admit that all that is true. Jesus taught this. The proper way to keep any, this is in conclusion. He taught the proper way to keep any commandment was to fulfill the purpose for which it was created. To fulfill the purpose, not to do the commandment. To fulfill the purpose of the commandment. You see, the Sabbath was supposed to be a blessing. It was for man. Man was made, right? The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. If it becomes a burden to you, then either you don't understand it or you're not applying it correctly. Or both. His teachings on the law also focused on inward obedience, or obedience of the heart, rather than outward legalistic obedience. Legalism is legalism when you say that this has to be done this way and everybody else has got to do what I'm doing. Everyone's on their own journey. So you may feel, you know, the Sabbath, as you look at the scriptures, you may look at a particular law and say, this is where I'm at for today. I can't judge you for the way that the Spirit's leading you. If He leads me to keep the Sabbath as the first thing that's the most important to Him for my life, He may lead you to a different law that you're breaking because of something that's in your life. Everyone has their own Acts 15. You see what I'm saying? We all come to the cross naked and bare. It's Him that says what needs to be fixed in our life. Yeshua's fulfillment of the law applies particularly to the sacrificial system, because that's what the sacrificial system is all about, was satisfying the curse that we deserved. He came the first time. Listen, He came the first time for one reason. To deal with the problem of sin. To deal with the problem of breaking the law. And not the problem of His perfect law. He did not come because His law was perfect and needed to be dealt with. Like, He created the law and then had to come spank the law. It doesn't make any sense. He didn't come because there was a problem with the law. He came because there was a problem with us. And the law that He wrote said that they're in trouble. He came to save His people. See it from a macro view? He will come the second time to bring salvation to all that endured. He's not going to deal with sin the second time. He's going to bring salvation. He is not going to come as Messiah ben Joseph, the humble servant. He's going to come as Messiah ben David, the reigning king. Amen. He will reward based on how much you love Him and your neighbor. Get that. Salvation is based on faith alone through the Messiah. But you prove your salvation by what you do. And you prove your salvation, you're rewarded by how much you love God and how much you love your neighbor. The question is, who defines how we love our neighbor? Do the residents of California define that? New Hampshire? If you're listening and you're California or New Hampshire, please forgive me. And He defines love this way. 1 John 5:3, for this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome. If they're burdensome, you're keeping the commandments of men. or someone has convinced you that you need to do something that the Spirit has not awakened you to yet. Yahweh did not do away with the Torah, the instructions for life. He did away with the power of sin and satisfied the debt that we could not pay that was due to it because we have broken His perfect law. It's the same message from beginning of Genesis when Adam sinned all the way through Revelation 22 when we're caught up and the Messiah finally comes home. And we rule and reign for 1,000 years. We only get to rule and reign because, by the way, we are Israel, which means to rule with Yahweh. Because we struggled and we overcame. We broke the law. We deserved death. He paid the price. Is this not the gospel we've all heard? We've just got it a little bit wrong. Because about 1700 and some odd years ago, the enemy had a very clear path. It started in the garden when he said, oh, by the way, God didn't really mean that. He didn't really mean to die. It's the same tactic that he's used 1700 and some odd years ago when Constantine and the emperors and all the Gentiles voted out all these biblical laws. And he said, you know, God didn't really mean for you to keep the law. Just as long he knows your heart. Do we not rail against the Jehovah's Witnesses, against the Mormons, against anybody that says anything outside of the Word of God? And their response is, I feel it in my bosom. I know it's right. He knows my heart. And we tell them, it doesn't matter whether you're sincere. It matters whether it's found in the Scriptures. Yet we do not apply the same principle to our own religion. Would you agree with me that in the year 2009, it's time for an audit? It's time that we audit our own religious system and find out, are we violating the very God that we say that we serve? Let's pray.
I surrender to the King. Singing a song of praise. My freedom, my sustain. I surrender to the King.